this is my art journal adventure page from weeks 23 and 24, and since it debuted, I've received a fair number of questions from people who are interested in learning how I make these flower and mandala shapes. They want to know how I keep the petals even and how I get the line weights and those kinds of things, and it's very simple. That's what I'm going to show you today. So let's slide the journal out of the way and let's talk about tools for a second. Now I'm going to work, this is one of the Strathmore 6x6 Bristol art tiles. I'm going to demo on this. It's a nice smooth surface. The journal that you just saw is one of the Dilusions square craft journals with the manila paper. Again, it works really well. I can do this on watercolor paper. The technique pretty much applies. The most important thing that you're going to want to know is, will the pencil that you use erase? Because you're going to put pencil guidelines in there. So, for example, this is a hard-leaded pencil. It's designated with an H, and you'll usually see that up on this end up here. If I sharpen this to a nice fine point, which I have, you can see that I can make a fairly light line. So then the question becomes, on this paper, can I easily erase that fairly light line? And this is a Pentel Click Eraser, and this is a Sanford Magic Rub Eraser. And you can see that with either of these, I can erase this. So I always test that first. So pencil and erasers is important. And then obviously the other thing that's important are the pens that you use. Any of you who watch these videos know that I'm a huge fan of Pitt pens. They're made by Faber-Castell. Typically, I'm going to work for a project like this or for sizes like this. I'm going to work with the S, the super fine, and the extra super fine tips. That one is designated with an XS. I'm also going to show you how I use the brush pens, which oftentimes is just to fill in areas. It's much easier to fill in with this brush tip if I do something like this than it would be even, for example, if I took the fine tip and I tried to scribble to fill in. It's very obviously much better to do it with the brush tip. So when you talk about line weights, that's the fine. This is the super fine. And this is the extra super fine. And you can see that there's a significant difference in the weight of each of these, and that's going to be important. This is something that's very simple to do. This is actually what I'm going to show you in just a couple of minutes. But when you look at this, you can see that all of these lines out here, the lines and those little loopy things here, the dots, almost everything on this was done with the extra super fine pen except for the outer parts of the petals. With that, I used the super fine. It's important because if you want to put little tiny lines in here, obviously the little tiny tip that you have or the point on that pen is important. So I'm going to come back in just a second. I want to show you how I lay out my circles and then how easy it is to actually start. Even though this looks very complex, if you look at it as individual elements and you look at each as an additional layer, you'll see how easy it is to go from very simple to something that's quite a bit more complex like this. I'm ready to get started on this flower, and the thing that you might have heard me say a moment ago is I need to create my circles. So let's talk about that for a second. These are the crux to everything I do. This is how I'm going to get petals that are all the same length. I'm going to start from a center, and with this penciled line, I actually have now a guideline and a place to aim the end of my petals at, and that'll make sense in a second. So this is the Picket Giant Circles template, and this is the Picket Small Circles template. And between these two, I pretty much can do everything that I need to. These are my go-to sizes, or versions, if you will. This is the biggest one on here is, I want to say, 3.5 inches. And then all the way down on here, you have this little weenie one that is so small I'd probably never use it, but nevertheless. So I want to start off by putting my flower center in place. And what you don't know, because you can't see the beginning stages of this, was that this outer dark circle here was my beginning point, the outer line on that. So let me just grab a circle here, and honestly I don't remember which one I started with, and though there are sizes marked on these, I almost never pay attention to them. In fact, I work from the back, that way I can't read them and sort of be distracted by the sizes. So I'm just going to pick a circle. Now for the center one like this, because I know I want this to be lined, I'm going to come in with the super fine pen and I'm just going to line it. Now this is not going to be centered on this piece of paper. ordinarily, if I were laying something out, and when I laid out that art journal adventure page I showed you a moment ago, I actually came in with pencil first and laid out all the circles and the half circles, so I kind of knew where everything was going to be. But for my purposes now, for this, I don't have to take that step. I can just line this initially with a pit pen. So here's my center circle in place. I'm not going to worry about the inner piece yet. What's important to me is to get my guideline for these outer petals in place. So if you come here, you can see that this all fits within the perimeter, within the interior of this, what is actually a 2¼-inch circle. So I'm going to use that again, but what I'm going to do, and here's where the pencil and the eraser comes in, I'm going to pencil this in first. So I'm not really good about measuring things. I pretty much eyeball everything. My rationale for that is that nothing is perfect in nature, and it sure as heck doesn't have to be perfect when I do it here. So I've got this nice line, light pencil line that I know I can use either one of the two of these to erase. So now what I want to do is start putting the petals in. And this is where the freehand part comes in. If you want to have them more or less equidistant, imagine the points on a clock. So if from your perspective, this would be 12, this would be 6, and then over here would either be 3 or 9. I can't figure out which way it would be. And then you can just see that I've got these alternates stuck in at the various other points. Now, I'm not going to mark this. I'm going to eyeball this because, again, that's what I do. If you want to be more precise about how you lay them out, you certainly can. So I can't talk and do this, so I'm actually going to not talk while I do it, other than occasionally to tell you what I'm doing. I find making petals like this is what works for me. My hand naturally makes that kind of a curve shape. This does not. They don't look particularly good when I do them that way, so I stick with what works. So though I don't have any designated 12 o'clock point yet, the minute I put a petal in, I will, and then I'll have to get my other one opposite of that. So let's get the first one in first. Now you can see that this is narrower at the bottom than it is at the top. It's a little bit squared off here on the end. You can see that it's not a loop that just barely touches this pencil mark. It actually follows it for a period. So now I'm going to turn this around 180 degrees, and I'm going to put what essentially becomes the 6 o'clock petal in. Now immediately you'll notice that the distance here is not the same as the distance here. If I really wanted to get super precise, I'm sure that I could make markings in here that would enable me to do that, but I can't be bothered, quite honestly. So now what I need to do is put my 6 and 9 o'clock petals in. And now I can just fill in the ones in the existing spaces. Now again, my distances here are not all the same. I'm not really worried about that. And you can see that in my original sample, the petals don't touch as they approach the center. So I'm going to kind of keep with that. And how simple is that? That's it. I have 8 petals in there that are all roughly the same distance from the center because I used my penciled guideline to know where to place those ends. So now what I'm going to do is just come in and erase the pencil mark. And this is the beginning of a flower. How much do you want to embellish it? Do you want to make it kind of open and not put a lot on it? Do you just maybe want to put a center and a little bit of line work on it? Or do you want to go a little bit more like this? I'm going to show you how I did this just so that you can see how you step through the process to start from here and end here. The first thing that I want to do is establish this center line here, the one that's filled in with black. And so my process for that is to pick an opening in the small circle template that's smaller, whatever degree of smaller you want. Do you want this line to be thick or thin? I mean, you can move this around until you find an opening on there that kind of gives you what you're looking for. If you want it narrower, then obviously you'll fill this in with a larger opening because that's going to give you a narrower circle. So I'm going to choose whatever size this is. Again, I deliberately work with it upside down so I don't get hung up on the numbers. And I'm going to use my super fine tip and I'm just going to mark this. So now I've got my ring and you can see that it's not perfectly centered. Again, I would have to care for that to matter. That's the way that I work. If you want to be more precise, I'll always say that you can do that. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to grab the brush tip and I'm going to fill this in with the brush tip. Now, one of the disservices, I think, when you see someone in working, and I'm not disparaging anyone, but I think what happens is when you see it work, you see someone working and the video has been sped up, I think it gives the false impression that you need to move quickly when you do this. I find that the opposite is true. I need to move slowly in order to get an accurate line around here when I fill this in. So bear in mind that slow is better until you get really adept at this, and maybe you'll pick up some speed, but I find that I get far better results if I move slowly, so that's what I'm going to do. So again, I have the brush tip. I'm going to start by lining the outside, and then I'm going to come in and line the inside, and then if there are any areas to be filled in, that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to try to work with long strokes rather than short, sketchy ones. I have this nice long tip that's going to allow me to do that. And again, I'm not going to talk. Alright, so actually what I need to do, I will confess, I wear reading glasses in order to be able to do most things, but for this work, I need some that are just a hair stronger that really allows me to see those lines. So I've switched to the slightly stronger glasses now, and I can actually see what I'm doing, which is always a benefit. Alright, so there's our center done. Let me bring the sample back in. You can see that I've got another ring in the center here. So what I need to do is find a couple of smaller openings on here. That's probably too big. But what I want to do is find an opening that's going to allow me to get this ring on the inside and leave this gap of white so that I can come in and dot it, which means I need to step down to a smaller opening on the template here. Make sure I grab the right pen, use my super fine tip. So I'm going to line that, and then I'm going to find a smaller opening still. That's probably not quite small enough. This is looking close. Again, I'm going to eyeball it in terms of center. So now what I have is this open ring, and what I'm going to do is use the extra super fine tip, and I'm going to put these dash marks in there. Now I could do this with a super fine if I wanted, but I like the more delicate look that I get with these fine lines with the extra super fine, so that's kind of what I'm doing. Or excuse me, that's why I'm doing this. All right, I'm not going to finish lining that. You don't need to see me make those lines. So then the next thing to look at are the little dots. Again, I'm going to use the extra super fine tip. And I'm just going to place them around this other ring right here. And of course I'm talking, so they wandered a little bit. Again, you don't need to see me finish that. But you can see how you get these layers of complexity. What started off very simple has now started to take on an entirely different look because I'm adding these extra elements. So then the next thing that I want to do is go back to the super fine tip, and I'm going to put these semicircles, these curved pieces here on the end. And all I do is eyeball from the edge of the petal to the edge of the petal. Try to kind of keep the arcs the same so that this distance from here to here is roughly the same on all of them. missed right there, didn't I? Alright, and then if I want to line those, I could use the super fine tip, but I'm going to come back to the extra super fine. Now, there are a couple of different ways you can approach this. One of the things that I find, if I'm not making straight lines, one of the ways to kind of fix that is to start at the center and line it straight up, and then that becomes my guide for all the subsequent ones after that. Now, I find it easier to turn this around. I can't, well, I can, but I don't do it as well. If I were to leave this the way that it was and start lining this way, I tend to not be as even as I would like. So it makes more sense for me, and though that one's not terribly even, it makes more sense for me to turn it around and work it this way. The other option is to simply start at one end and line until you reach the other one. Again, you can see the complexity starting. This is starting to look far more, busy is not the word that I'm looking for, but it looks far more interesting because there are more things going on. So if we look at these little half circle things that are going on here, you just fit them in. Around the perimeter of this half semicircle thing that you did. Very straightforward. They don't have to be even. I try to keep the same number since the petals are all relatively the same size. It's fairly easy to keep the same number in there. So then what that really leaves us is this business right here. So I'm going to make a little loop like that, and then what I'm going to do is when I come back to make this loop, I'm going to come over this little leg here and I'm just going to increase the distance up here. So it gives me that kind of a look. The other option would be to do this. So you have more of a half moon shape, but that wasn't really what I was looking for. So by tracing over part of the area again, it creates a shape that looks a little bit different. Do this all the way around, and then you could do this with the super fine tip, and in fact, as I look at this, I can tell that I did this with the super fine tip, but then when it comes time to line it, you really do need the extra super fine tip. And you can just go in and fill in. Now the other thing, the only other piece of this that's missing is the dots. Now I will confess that this is not as well done as this, but I'm talking in the middle of this and I'm not actually filling in any one area. But you can see how easy it is to go from that plain flower that we worked with a moment ago into something that's far more complex like this. One of the interesting variations on this process is to not use concentric circles when you start to put your guidelines in. And by that I mean, once you have your center circle in, when you pencil that circle in, that outer one that where your petals will rest against, you can see that I've deliberately offset that so that the petals that are here are going to definitely be shorter than the petals that are here. And that's exactly what I did for this process. Now, it creates some very interesting effects. For example, if we look at this one right here, you can see that they weren't done concentrically either. I've got much shorter dashed lines over here than I do up here, and even on this inner circle here with the circles in it, you can see that they're smaller here than they are here, and that just kind of further emphasizes that irregular nature. And I don't think that one is necessarily better than the other. I think that they just are a variation of one another, and it's another opportunity for you to create some really interesting effects. So when you do this, nothing changes. All I'm going to do is grab, well, where's my the one I have set up here. I'm going to grab my super fine pen, and this time I'm going to just use pointy petals just for variation, another kind of variation. Who wants to do the same thing over and over? When you look at this process, and I probably shouldn't be talking while I do this, as you start to come around the circle, since I'm not doing the 12-6 9 and 3 business anymore. I'm just filling in randomly. The key is, if you want your petals to be about the same size, to make the distance between here and here the same pretty much all the way around. Now, that doesn't mean you can't do different things. For example, if I started, I'm not gonna, but if I started to make petals, and as I got into this larger area, I made these distances bigger, I'd end up with bigger petals in the area, and then I could start to make them smaller again. It becomes kind of an optical illusion thing. For the sake of keeping it simple, I'm just gonna make them roughly the same size, and you'll see as I start to come around the center, I'm gonna have to start judging when I've got some, what room I've got left and how many petals I can fit in, but let me get there first. I think I have room for probably two more after this. That seems to be about right. So I'm going to kind of visually split the distance here. And that actually looks pretty good. So that's how simple it is. And it's a question of, well, what else do I want to do? So what do I want to do? And now you actually fall into the next question is when is a flower a mandala? Or what happens, when does one become the other, or when does it never happen? And I think the line between them is actually pretty sketchy and pretty vague. I think that this is more of a mandala because it's more closed in and you don't have open petals along the edge like you do here. Maybe you think something differently. I think that mandalas tend to be a little bit more elaborate in the way that this is more elaborate and looks less like a flower. I mean, this is pretty obviously a flower, but if you could see this, well, let me move this, sorry, this is pretty obviously a flower, but if you could see this full size, and I came back and I started to put more circles, more rings around here, and maybe I filled them in so that they were solid, at that point I think it starts to cross the line and becomes more of a mandala and less of a petal. So let's just play with that for a second. Let me bring in the circle templates. So I think that this is a 2¼-inch circle. Yep, that looks about right. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to see if I can take this flower and kind of push it to the limit and see if it becomes a mandala. All right, so that's not what I want. Here's my super fine tip. I'm going to keep the extra super fine nearby. And this probably will not be perfectly precise, but it's pretty darn close. Okay, so now I've got that closed in, and I've got a little bit of overhang there. So maybe what I could do would be to come in, and I'm not gonna fill this in, but my notion would be that I would fill this in with the black brush pen, create a band here, and I think now that I'm stepping more toward a mandala, so let's just put a little bit of color in there so we get a sense of what it looks like. And remember, especially for this, it's important to go slowly. All right, so let me just fill this in ever so slightly right here. You can see that I've disguised that little spot where my petal actually stuck into that ring. So now you think, all right, well, what's next? I think what I would do would be to come in here. That might not be quite big enough. Whoops. And that might be a little bit too big, but I think I'm going to go this route. So I'm going to pencil this circle in. Now I'm going to stick, well, do I want to stick with concentric? I think I'm going to stick with concentric at this point. I've got my center off, and I think that that's enough. So now what I'm going to do is just pencil this in. I'm going to grab my super fine tip, and I'm just going to come in and put some motifs around here. And this is another one of those where you just kind of wing it as you go along. I like this shape. It's one that I use fairly frequently. As I begin to come around here, eventually I'll have to start eyeballing that the way that I did when I was doing this so that I can figure out when I'm getting to the point where I have perhaps 2 to 3 left and I need to space them to fit them in there. So you can see that now this starts to become even more interesting, but here's where you can take it to the next step if you want. And it's each of those additional little layers that you stick onto these that starts to make them look so much more complex and they become so interesting. So I'm going to swap to my slightly stronger glasses and I'm going to pick up the extra super fine pen. Now, one of the things that I've discovered is that if I make a circle, I tend to do them like this, but I also tend right there to not get really good closures, where the two ends meet. So what I have found is if I start that here, then I can disguise my beginning and end right at the point, but I can't do it while I'm talking. Now that one's leaning a little bit, but it's okay. And again, this just becomes degrees more interesting every time you add a layer of complexity. So there's probably an unlimited number of variations on this theme. You can see that I really, except for circles and long or short dashes, I really didn't repeat a whole lot in this particular page, and you see what an enormous variation there is. So when you think about making these kind of flowers or these kind of mandalas, remember that your best friend is going to be that hard lead pencil and something like, or these exact, circle templates.